A member of the Saint Lucia Labour Party during the time the island sought statehood, former politician Peter Josie reveals that he and the party were indeed pro-independence. He, George Odlum and the SLP, he says, were painted as being opposed to it by the John Compton-led United Workers' Party. Independence, says the former politician, was the only way that Saint Lucia could have been developed, but the idea was to militarize the society, an idea which was interpreted as communism.
You cannot develop a country without your youth being trained to defend the country, to work for the country. When you reach Form 5, either 16, 17, whatever age, you should be registered as a voluntary youth worker for the country. On Saturdays, when you have free time, you begin, or your name is registered everywhere in the government service.
But you would admit, though, Peter, that at the time, looking at the time period that we were in, and given all that was taking place...
Given Fidel Castro and Cuba.
And Cuba and Grenada, the events happening in Grenada as well, that when you speak about
military discipline,
the signing up of youngsters, people immediately associated that with communism.
Yeah, but why? Why? They have not read the history of America to know how America was transformed. What is the name of that president, Rick, who began the work thing in the United States when they had the Depression? Even President Kennedy, JFK, what did he do? The young Americans were graduating. What did he do? He started the Peace Corps movement where young Americans were trained and were working all over the world voluntarily.
On the other hand, journalist Rick Wayne believes that St. Lucia's attainment of statehood was, in his words, fake. According to him, independence was used as a political football by the SLP and UWP simply to score political points, and that the reality of what an independent state truly is was never on the table. Independence, he explains, was a fait accompli as colonial powers were at that time themselves seeking to dispose of the colonies that they saw as dead weight.
The Labour Party, or whatever the group was, Peter and so on, were against whatever Compton was talking about in terms of independence. The matter of communism, there was never any communism in St. Lucia.
Thank you, Rick.
Communism was a bogeyman.
Thank you.
And so for election purposes, from the days of Peter Josie and George in the forum, were called communists. It didn't require any explaining. People were not interested in an explanation. There was nothing about militarizing anything. Communism was the devil. And so Compton painted those guys as the devil who were against independence. The reality as now was seldom ever discussed on the road to independence. The independence itself became a political football. One side was against it, so they said whatever they needed to say and do against it, just like now. But independence was the day's DSH, I suppose. You know, that's what it was. Independence was never really on the table. The people were conned, and Compton admitted that later on. But I have to say, George, Peter, and them also conned the people.
Josie, who agreed with Wayne's take on the island statehood, disclosed why he and others of the opposition Labour Party took on the roles they did in the narrative of St. Lucia's road to independence.
Whether we liked it or not, Rick, the point is that a group of 24 at the United Nations had mandated the thing we call independence. So we had to play along, whether it was fakery or not.
Yep.
It's not material. It was not material at the time. Mm-hmm. Because if we did not go, then England would give John Compton and Henry Girodi, who went with him, and Parry Husbands, these were the three guys. Parry was the Attorney General. Henry was chairman of the UWP. They would have gotten all what they wanted in the Constitution without an input from the opposition.
For the DBS News World, I am Zane Romulus.